In the previous module, you have explored vector datasets, where each feature is described by a certain geometry and corresponds to a row of the attribute table. Raster datasets have a quite different structure. We are going to see how R handles this type of spatial data. But first, let's download a raster dataset and open it in QGIS. We are going to use raster climatic data from WorldClim, and in particular, average precipitation values over Central Europe for a 30-year period. The site is easy to visit. If you don't want to download a climatic variable for the whole globe, you can just select a tile, which we do in this example. We select precipitation values for tile 16. After downloading precipitation data, unzip the file, you'll get 12 GeoTIFF files, one for each month of the year. In QGIS, we open GeoTIFF file for the month of August. The properties of this dataset are quite different than the properties of the vector datasets. You can find those in the properties of the raster layer. You can see that the coordinate reference system is again WGS84 with geographic coordinates latitude and longitude. The extent is 30 by 30 degrees, and the resolution is 30 seconds. Therefore, this raster has 3600 rows and 5600 columns. QGIS is very nice to explore raster data, and in particular to zoom in over a region of interest. You can use the Identify tool to determine the value at a given pixel. Some pixels might have a no data value. The few examples we are going to discuss will help us to understand how R handles raster data. It will also show that you can export data directly to a file. We will exemplify this by building a histogram of the raster dataset values and exporting it as a PNG file. Then, we will show how to output the result of a R operation back to QGIS. And finally, we are going to see how we can access the pixel coordinates in R to solve a problem which is hard to deal with just with standard QGIS operations. As before, we're going to write a R script to read this layer. However, since it's a raster dataset, the input is going to be of type raster. So the header is going to be slightly different than in the case of vector layers that were explored in the previous module. In this first example, we see that the input is of type raster. In R, this is converted into an object of class raster, defined by the package with the same name. As before, slot names will return the slots of the object, which is now of class raster. Values and coordinates are two important functions that return respectively the values and the coordinates of all pixels of the raster dataset. The header indicates the group where this script is going to be stored, and the input of type raster. In R, this input is stored in the variable of your choice. Then we load the package raster. Finally, we wash the names of the slots and the values of the slot CRS. After we run the script, we see the slot names and the coordinate reference, which is WGS84, as we knew from looking at the metadata in QGIS. Next, we look at the output of values and coordinates. Since these are very large matrices, we only look at their structure. Values return a matrix with one column and about 13 million rows, the total number of pixels. The output of coordinates has the same number of rows but two columns, which are longitude and latitude in this example. You can verify this in the output of your R script. In this example, we are going to build an histogram of the raster dataset values and export that histogram as a PNG file using the R command PNG, which diverts the output to the file my_hist.txt. Hist is the R command that builds a histogram from a set of values. The arguments xlab and main determine respectively the x-axis label and the title of the plot. Finally, the command dev.off closes the connection to the file. Histograms are a very important tool in image processing, and QGIS is very limited in that respect. Hence, R is a very convenient way to create well-designed histograms. We write the R script discussed in the previous slide. Here, the function png diverts the output to the chosen file. In alternative, you can output the plot to the result viewer available at the processing drop-down menu. When you run the script, the output is empty, but we can find the output file in the location we have chosen, opening the respective folder. This third example shows how one can send the output back to QGIS. In order to do this, we need to define a new header variable, which is of type output raster, since we are going to output a raster R object to QGIS as a raster layer. In this example, the new layer is going to be a mask for precipitations above 50 millimeters. First, we are going to see that what is the R object defined by the logical condition R larger than 50. It is still an object of class raster with the same extension and resolution as the original input. But each valid pixel value is now either 1 if the precipitation is larger than 50 or 0 otherwise. We can run the script to see this. The new R object has now values ranging from 0 to 1, where 1 indicates that the precipitation of the pixel is larger than 50 millimeters. Next, we are going to export that result to QGIS as a variable named mask. To achieve this, we need a new header comment that indicates that mask is going to be converted into a new QGIS layer. As a result, a new layer is created in QGIS. However, no data values are displayed with the same color as the value 1, which makes the map hard to read. To obviate this, we alter the color legend of the new layer using so-called pseudocolors. So 1 will be represented by green, and 0 will be represented by red, leaving no data values as background in this example. We can see that the resulting map makes sense, since Mediterranean areas, which are typically dry in summer, have value 0, while the remaining regions have precipitation values above 50 millimeters, with a few exceptions. In this last example, we first treat the raster dataset values with the function values, as we did before. Then, we read the coordinates of all pixels in the raster and save them in the object XY, which, as we have discussed earlier, is a two-column matrix where each row corresponds to a pixel. The first column are the X coordinates. In this case, Those are the longitude in degrees. And the Y column corresponds to the Y coordinates, the latitudes for this data set. Then we join the information on coordinates and on values into a single matrix, and we can look for the rows of the matrix which have the maximum precipitation values. This will give us the answer to our problem. Let's paste the script in the previous slide and look at the output. Here, I'm just adding a comment that shows the first rows of M, since this is a very large matrix. Now, when you run the script, you need to choose the right input, since there are two layers available. In the output, you'll see that the maximum average precipitation in August is 234 millimeters. The which function will tell you that the maximum is reached at 2 pixels and will tell you which the indices are. You can see the header of the M matrix with its three columns and the NA values that correspond to water pixels. Finally, the selected rows show the longitudes and latitudes of about 9 and 47 degrees, which is over Switzerland, where the precipitation is maximum. From this information, one could construct a point vector object with those locations and output it as a new point vector layer in QGIS.